Good evening and welcome to Tinkering with Edkelar. As you might have noticed, I'm in the process of building a collection of old school technology. Radio, computer, TV, you name it. While I don't want to limit myself to electronics, those are certainly going to be the main focus. I already restored two CRT-based devices before. The JVC radio and TV combo and the Commodore, or rather Philips monitor. Both of which would have needed some test signals to align the tube properly, but I did not have any at the time. This is where a recent eBay search kicked in. I was looking for a pattern generator and expected something cheapish, plasticky. But here I had an offer that caught my eye and spoke to me. A Philips PM5515, a color TV test pattern generator. Not only does it provide PAL and NTSC output, but it also comes with an RF modulator. That means I can finally adjust the JVC radio, which doesn't have a direct video input at all. Sweet! As usual, I follow my turn it on after messing with it rule set. Anything older than 20 or so years should have at least a close inspection. Electrolytics are wet components and can dry up just by aging. And I'm pretty sure that most of the chips in this beauty aren't around anymore, so I don't want to end up blowing some of them up. A battery. Claws crossed. Better look up the service manual. A quick Google search later, I knew that this device came in a slew of versions. Mine seems to be the base model, mono audio and no teletext module, as well as an older RGB output module without S-video. Oh well, beggars can't be choosers. Anyway, the battery is for the preset storage, so no calibration was lost. And yes, the battery has 0 volts. Dead as a dodo. Disassembly was a bit wonky. While some stuff was plugged in, like the front panel board and transformer, and the unit itself was quite modular, with some expansion boards, some parts were just soldered in place, like the HF output module, the power leads, and the potentiometers for the front panel. I ordered a set of electrolytics along with a battery holder that seemed to be a good match. It's hard to tell if the footprint matches the old battery though. Potentiometers got, as usual, a good inside-out cleaning. the grease had become quite stiff. Now I get that some force is expected to prevent accidental changes, but these old pots are way too stiff. If you can hardly turn it without the attached knob, it needs fresh grease. That's my baseline. Replacing the capacitors was the usual remove, replace, repeat operation, but with quite a few of those buggers and quite different values, it was a bit of a slow process. Did I mention that the PCBs don't have any silkscreen on them? And my service manual is of a slightly newer version, so I can't rely on that info and have to replace the caps one by one. And since there are negative rails in here, even the orientation isn't always minus goes to ground. Sheesh! The push buttons are domed switches and their semi-transparent cases made me see that the insides would be pretty corroded. So I decided to remove the domes, clean them and reassemble. Well, that worked. Almost. I am glad that the board seems to be the same for all models of the series. Two of the domes didn't want to spring anymore. But my version has several unused switches, so I could leave those open. Whoops! After cleaning all the parts, I begin reassembling the thing. Lots of screws. Before I turn it on, however, I thought, let's pull out the EPROMs and read them so I can archive the contents just in case. And whoops! Pin 1 of the digital board's EPROM was slightly bent. But only slightly. It seems that the pin on the socket was broken, so I replaced that. And since the pin on the IC was so warped, it didn't take well to the new socket at all. A bit of solder made it just good enough to make contact. I start off by connecting everything that is needed to test the supply rails. The main PCB, transformer, and power switch. And the moment of truth or dare. Dare I turn it on? Okay, 3, 2, 1, no smoke. Good. Let's measure the supply rails and adjust those. Plus minus 12 volts and 5 volts, as well as 6.1 volts. Good. Before I plug in any of the boards, I check if there's anything getting warm. Ow! Hey, that's not just warm. Why is the EPROM so hot? Oh, the notch is pointing that way. I see. Oops. Good thing I saved the contents, because this one is definitely still working fine. Whoa, they sure don't make them like this anymore. After connecting everything again, I check to see if the output looks even remotely like a video signal. And it does! Sweet! Connecting up my trusty 10-inch flat panel. Woohoo! Picture! Standard selection switch would not rotate back to PAL for some reason. I thought, oh darn, now I have to replace that. Only to realize that one of the eyepieces of the transformer core got loose and was interfering. That's a quick fix. Moving on. A sleepless night later, I had adjusted all the values I could verify with my scope. And the output image looks crisp and clear. Sweet! Completing the case next. Thank you. And done! I now have a working and, well, almost calibrated test pattern generator for PEL and NTSC. Yay! The next monitors can come! And that's it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed the project. See you next time! It's hard to tell if the footprint matches the old battery though. And why is it called a footprint? Shouldn't it be called a paw print?